So again, good morning, everyone. Good morning. Welcome to all of you. Thanks for joining us to worship God in spirit and in truth. We welcome those who are online as well. We thank you for joining us. There's digital connection cards. If this is one of your first times worshiping with us, we would appreciate you sharing your information. We would love to bring you a little welcome gift along with those who are here in person for the first or second time. You can fill out the card that's in the bulletin. We have a bunch of announcements, but I will be sharing those later on. So the joy of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let's worship God.
And with us.
You may be seated. Friends, if we say we have no sin, the truth is not in us and we are self-deceived. But if we confess our sins, our God who is faithful and just, he will forgive us all our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So in humility and faith, let us pray to God. God Almighty, you are the creator of everything that is, and you have made a wonderful, beautiful world. Lord, I want to thank you for the incredible hymn that we just sang, Lord, and we're going to look forward to singing the last two verses in just a minute, Lord. Music is such a gift, and we praise you for it. We praise you, Lord, for the melodies and the rhythms that are at the core of creation. We praise you for speaking to people and blessing them with the gifts of music. We praise you, Lord, for the stars and the sea and the land. We praise you for our brothers and sisters in Christ and all human beings everywhere, Lord. Your spirit is upon them, and we ask, O Lord, that you would wake them up to the gifts inside them, that you would wake them up to your presence, to your love, to your truth, to your peace. We pray, O Lord, that you would grant them faith, which will open all these things up. We thank you, Father, for love and mercy. And we ask, Father, that you would come to us in the spirit of Jesus, who forgave the sins of the sinful around them and welcomed them, and asked them to break bread together, share stories. We pray, Father, that you would forgive us just as you forgave them. Help us to know that you will never let us go. Lord, there are things that weigh us down, and we pray that you would help us to release them unto you right now, that we might know the lightness of being in your Son. Hear our silent confessions as we bow before Jesus on the cross. I want you to hear the good news. The grace of the Lord, the mercy of God is from everlasting to everlasting. Anyone who is in Christ Jesus is a new creation. The old life has gone. All of those sins have been put to death on the cross of Christ Jesus, and a new life in the Holy Spirit of grace and love has begun. So know that you are forgiven and be at peace. And let's stand and give glory to God. Friends, knowing that we have been forgiven in Christ Jesus, we must share that forgiveness with each other and the world. The peace of Christ be with you all. So just a few announcements. We've started board games again on Saturdays at 1 p.m. And so if you've never played Euro games, strategic Euro games, they are amazing. They're so much more fun than what we grew up with. Parcheesi and Monopoly, and those games are fine, but they just are not the same. The games have developed tremendously, and they're a blast. And there's easy ones, and there's medium weight ones, and there's super hard ones, and we play them all. So come any Saturday at 1 p.m. We call them interfaith board games because we have people from all different faith traditions coming, and so everybody is, of course, welcome. We have a board game convention that we're going to do on November 4th, so set that date aside especially. It's going to be raising money for charity, both our food bank and also a board gaming charity company that gives board games out to less privileged children. And so set aside November 4th and come and join us for that. Next week we start our youth groups, so the Kingdom Kids and the Joyful Noise are going to be gathering at 5 o'clock, and then the youth groups and everybody, families included, are going to have a meal at 6 o'clock. And then at 6:20, the youth are gonna break apart and have a lesson. So we might change the youth group date depending on the availability of the youth, but for now, this is what we're doing. So please let your children and grandchildren know about that wonderful night. Crop Walk is going to be here at the church on October 22nd. We'll get some envelopes. I think we still got some downstairs for you to raise money in person if you want to go knock on doors. And the easiest thing to do is just raise money online. Send the electronic link to all of your folks and say, please give for the hungry and those suffering from natural disasters in our world, and help us raise money and raise awareness when we walk together with people from all different faith traditions here on October 22nd. The thrift shop is open, and from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. you can go and buy some good stuff. They could really use your help as well, and so please consider volunteering at the thrift shop. Men, we're going out on September 29th. Please let me know if you're interested in breaking bread and having some drinks. It's going to be a good night, and so we look forward to that. And that, I believe, is all I have. Are there any other announcements? No? All right. Children, come on forward for the children's message. Did anybody not get a backpack tag last week? William didn't get one. There you go. You're welcome. Take that one for Hannah. Okay. All right. Christina gets one, and Olivia gets one as well. We blessed backpacks last week and children. So I'm going to talk to you today about a guy named Paul. You've heard me talk about him before. He was really, really smart. And when he was growing up, he studied really hard. And he became an expert. Oh, Maddie, what's a matter, dear? What's a matter? Oh, poor thing. She says, I don't want to come up with the children's message. No, thank you. I was happy the way I was. So Paul studied really hard growing up, and he became an expert in the law. Do you know what the law is? The law is the rules in our society that teach us right from wrong and punish us when we do wrong and sometimes reward us when we do right, but there's not a whole lot of rewards for doing right. You just got to do it. You just got to obey. And so the law that Paul memorized was the Old Testament law. It was the law of God. And Paul knew it so well, and he took it so seriously that people who broke the law, he would really punish them, including the Christians, including the followers of Jesus. When people started following Jesus and maybe breaking the Sabbath, which means working on the holy day instead of just worshiping God and resting, if people fed people or healed people on the Sabbath, Paul would get mad. And also, they didn't have right ideas about God, and Paul was going to punish them for their wrong ideas about God, too. And so he did all kinds of mean things to them, until one day, Jesus appeared to him, the risen Jesus. So Jesus had already died and had rose from the grave. And when Paul was in the midst of doing all these bad things to followers of Jesus, Jesus showed himself to him and said, Paul, what are you doing? You're hurting my children. You need to stop it. And in fact, Paul was going to have to go and share love with those lawbreakers, those people who were breaking the law of God. He was going to have to go to Greeks and Turks. They weren't called Turks back in that day, but people in modern day Turkey. He's going to go to people all around, Romans, and he was going to say to them, guess what? I know that heaven is real. I know that when we die, we're going to be judged. And we're going to be judged by this guy named Jesus. He's how I know that heaven is real. Because he was dead, but he rose again and he showed himself to me. And so Paul went to people throughout the Mediterranean world and shared this good news with them. And the really hard thing was that Jesus told Paul, Paul, you're not going to be strict about the law anymore. Those Greeks and those Romans, they don't know the Old Testament law, and they don't keep the Old Testament law. They have a different way of life. And so you're not going to punish them for not keeping the law of God. In fact, quite the opposite. If you try and make people keep that law, that is the worst thing you can do in some ways. Because it scandalizes them. It makes them think, oh, I'm a bad person. And it makes them think that God doesn't love me. And it makes them think that they have to do things that they don't want to do. And so Jesus told Paul, the law is no longer in place, the Old Testament law. Instead, grace and love are in place. And all you have to do is point people to Jesus. And if they believe in Jesus, they're going to live right. They're going to love other people. They're going to do what was right. So just point people to Jesus and teach them about Jesus. That's all you have to do. And so that's what Paul did. But in those early churches, I told you about him going to Romans and Greeks and also Jews. He went to his fellow Jews as well. And so there were lots of different kinds of people in the early church, just like there's lots of different kinds of people here in our church. And sometimes those people didn't get along very well. Some of them were really strict about their diets. They said, I'm only going to be a vegetarian. I'm not going to eat meats. And being a vegetarian is the way God wants me to be. You shouldn't eat meat anymore. Or some of them said, well, you can eat some meat, but you can't eat pork and you can't eat bacon. And some people are like, pork and bacon? That's my favorite. I'm not going to stop eating that. And so people would quarrel about these things. And they said, like, we have to keep every holy day. We have to keep Rosh Hashanah. Rosh Hashanah is what your Jewish friends are celebrating right now. That's the Jewish New Year. And we have to celebrate that. And we have to celebrate Yom Kippur, the day of forgiveness and the day of atonement. And Paul said, if you want to celebrate that, great. But don't make other people celebrate that. And so in school this year, I want you to do a couple of things. Some of your friends and classmates might bring some strange things for lunch. And we got a picture of something that is interesting. Have you ever seen that before? California rolls or sushi, right? Sometimes Asian people are made fun of in school for bringing seaweed and other things like this to school. They think it's different. What is that? And they give a yucky face, like, ugh, right? Don't do that, okay? Be nice, be kind, ignore what other people are eating, or say to them, wow, that looks good. That looks delicious, all right? And when holidays come around, wish people a happy new year. It's Rosh Hashanah, as I mentioned, we got a picture of that. So you can say to your Jewish friends, Happy New Year. Right now it's their New Year instead of January 1st. So say Happy New Year. And when Halloween comes, say a Happy Halloween to everybody. I'm going to talk to you about Halloween and how it's a hallowed eve before All Saints Day. It's a holy evening. That's what Halloween means. And say, of course, Happy Thanksgiving to everybody. But know that not everybody is going to be celebrating the same holidays. And that's okay. All right? Rejoice in the God who is behind all holy days and who calls us to love and to mercy and to truth. Wonderful listening, boys and girls. Kristen's going to take you down to Sunday school, but we're going to pray first. Let's have a prayer. Repeat after me. God of love, everybody, thank you so much for the gift of food. Help us to rejoice in all of it and remember and taste and see that you are good. Help us to celebrate all holidays and welcome and include and love all people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. Great job, boys and girls. Enjoy Sunday school. So interestingly, in Romans chapter 14, Paul calls people weak and strong in faith. And he says, welcome the weak, but not for the sake of quarreling. And interestingly, the weak ones are those who are strict about their diet and those who are strict about celebrating the holy days. Those are the ones that Paul calls weak. Those who are more free-spirited and eat anything and celebrate or don't celebrate, those are the ones who are strong. And I think the reason for that is because it's the weak who start quarrels, right? It's the strict, according to the law, the strict about right and wrong, the strict about ways of life. It's those who judge and start fights. And Paul says, stop it. Just stop it. And we hear a similar story today from Matthew chapter 18 about a forgiving Lord and an unforgiving servant. So let's listen to Matthew chapter 18, starting at the 21st verse. Then Peter came and said to Jesus, "Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as seven times?" Jesus said to him, "Not seven times, but I tell you, 77 times. By the way, we don't stop at 77. I've been keeping track. That's 77 times. I'm not going to forgive you anymore. Right? The point is, and sometimes the translation is 70 times seven times, which would be 490. And we don't keep track up to 490. The point is, we keep forgiving and forgiving just as God keeps forgiving us. And then Jesus told a parable. "For this reason, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. And as he could not pay, his lord ordered him to be sold, together with his wife and children and all his possessions, and payment to be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, 'Have patience with me, and I will pay you everything.'" So from the get-go, Jesus puts everybody on an equal footing, because the king in the passage is the king of all creation, the Lord, and everybody else, every single one of us, is a servant or a slave. And boy, is that uncomfortable language in the modern world. We don't like the idea of being a servant or a slave. Either translation is okay. We like to think of ourselves as kings and queens of our own lives. We don't serve anybody. We are the lords of our lives. And don't try and tell me what to do or what not to do, because I am free and I can do whatever I want, whenever I want to, as long as I'm not breaking the law. Again, the law comes into it. And if I'm breaking the law, then I'll get what I deserve. But guess what? That's not how it works. We all have a Lord, and we're all deeply indebted to the Lord. We have all been made by God, the Creator, and life itself is a gift. This body, this life, is something that God has given you. It's an absolute miracle that you exist at all. And existing means being indebted, having to pay back my life to the one who created me. And the one who created me also pervades creation and sustains everything that is, and pervades creation in terms of a moral order. In fact, teaching us right and wrong and calling us to do what is right according to Jesus Christ. None of our laws are perfect, only Jesus is perfect. And we need to keep our eyes on him and become better disciples of his way. And when we do so, we're going to be going out into the world to show the kind of love and peace and mercy that the Lord has shown us. Here's what the Lord does when we're willing to bow before him and beg him for mercy, because we're all indebted. Here's what the Lord does. On to the next slide, Nemat. "Out of pity for this slave, the Lord of that slave released him and forgave him the debt." So the real important question is whether or not we recognize that we are indebted slaves. Do we recognize that we are called to be loving servants each and every day, and to do our best to love just as Jesus loved? And do we recognize that we ourselves do not love as Jesus loved, and therefore we are indebted, and we need to fall down on our knees and ask for mercy, just as this slave did? Because when we do, what happens? The God of all creation says, "You are forgiven. You are loved. Now go out in the power of my Holy Spirit to love and to serve as my Son loved and served. Follow his Spirit. Keep growing in the Spirit of my Son, Jesus Christ." I'm continuing now in the story of what happened then and what happens too often with us. Verse 28, but that same slave, as he went out, he came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii. Remember, he was forgiven. And by the way, this word forgiveness and this word debt, it has a financial component. When we talk about it, we're talking about financial matters as well. So that those who are indebted and crushed by debt in our world, we need to figure out ways to forgive them some or all of their debts so that they are no longer oppressed by that debt. There's a financial component to indebtedness in the Bible. So the same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed him 100 denarii, and seizing him by the throat, he said, "Pay what you owe." Then his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, "Have patience with me, and I will pay you." But he refused. Then he went and threw him into prison until he would pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their lord all that had taken place. Then his lord summoned him and said to him, "You wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you?" This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So I've been watching a new documentary taking me back to my youth and my love of professional wrestling. I used to tug on my mom's dress or her pants when we were at church on Sunday mornings, and she wanted to fellowship and fellowship and chat, chat, chat. But I had to get home to watch AWA wrestling. Started at 11 o'clock. So I've been watching, I'm not that into wrestling anymore, but really, really interesting documentary on professional wrestling and a local regional, like the last regional wrestling company that has survived. And the wrestlers, generally speaking, are people who have just this troubled past. They haven't had enough love. They haven't had enough mercy. And one of them talked about how when they get, you know, when they walk through the curtain, whether they're, you know, whether they're a villain or a hero, right? All of a sudden, they're getting attention and in some ways getting the affirmation, the love that they deserve and that they need. Whether they deserve it or not, they need it. They need it. And she talked about how meaningful, how powerful that is. And one of the main reasons is because those folk, they're enacting the great moral drama of life. Now stick with me for a second. Right? Because you have heroes and you have villains. You have good and you have evil. And they're presenting a story of good and evil each and every week. And everybody who's there or who is watching on TV is participating in this great moral struggle between good and evil as well. And so the wrestlers, the participants, everybody involved gets in touch with the moral order that I talked about earlier. And they participate in the great story of God and the victory of goodness and love that the world was shown in Jesus Christ. I got to thinking about all those poor folks. They're hardly perfect, and maybe the drama is not the drama that they ought to be presenting. It's an imperfect drama, just as the drama that we present here on Sunday morning in our own worship is an imperfect drama. And then they go out and live, and they're not perfect in the ways that they're living, but they've been shown the mercy and the love, and they've been participating in the story that God is calling them to be. And I got to thinking about all the poor folk out there who don't get that same affirmation and who aren't participating on a weekly basis in the great drama of God. I got to thinking about those who are crushed by debt. I got to thinking about this company. The company is struggling, and it might not survive. Luckily, they got some smart investors And the investors called Netflix, I think, and said, "We got a great story for you, Netflix." And Netflix gave them $1 million or whatever it is to come and make this documentary. But I got to thinking, if they don't survive, this great participation in the story of good versus evil goes away. And in many ways, they lose their sense of purpose, and they can be easily brought into a place of despair, because there's so much despair out there. Friends, we got to figure out what to do. You know, we've had poverty in impoverished Black communities for decades, and we've had poverty in rural America for decades as well, and it's getting worse. And the biggest problem is that people are no longer in touch with the great story that can bring healing and hope. Year by year, decade by decade, people come to church less and less. People are involved in community less and less. And so people are finding substitutes. What did I hear? A great quote. Those who don't have a purpose and a meaning, they distract themselves with pleasure. Right? If you don't have a purpose and you don't have a meaning, and the work that you do week in and week out, if that doesn't have a purpose, and you don't understand that purpose, or you don't understand that purpose, then you fill your life with distractions and pleasures instead of striving with all that you are for the very purpose for which you live, which is to honor and glorify God and spread His love and His mercy. I don't think we understand, those of us who have tens or hundreds of thousands of dollars or more in the bank, I don't think we really understand the plight of the poor around us. I really don't. Good thing I don't need that. I hope. Was it the last page? Linda's going to get it for me just in case. Thank you, Linda. There's a new book out by a guy, a business management professor, who wrote it with Oprah Winfrey. And he was on Morning Joe, and it sounded really, really interesting. I think he's right on target. But when I looked at the reviews on Amazon, there were it's a brand new book, so there were only 100 reviews. 53 of the reviews were 5-star, and 47 of the reviews were 1-star. So nothing in between. And almost all of the 1-star reviews had something to do with more rich people telling us poor people how we can be happy. That's a reality. And we need to figure out how to change the cultures, or help, not change the cultures, but help people who used to have solid jobs in industry and manufacturing and have nothing now. Clean energy. Great. I love clean energy. Don't get me wrong. But we have millions who can't find good jobs anymore, and we have to figure out what to do about it in rural places and in African-American communities of poverty. The book is on target because it's a scientific book, and so they looked at all the data on happiness, and they talked about how faith and community and purpose are critical to happiness. What's been declining in our nation? Faith, life in community, and leadership. Amen, Rob. Amen. Leadership. But guess who the leaders are? All of us. All of us. There are some more powerful leaders who need to be doing a better job and making a better example. No doubt about it. But we need to be the example. We need to be the example in our own lives. And yes, we need to do everything in our power to vote to get those folks who aren't leading the way that they ought to be leading out of office. Amen. And we also ought to have term limits, because there's too much self-interest in politics these days. People only do what their constituents are wanting them to do for the sake of getting reelected. And it's not even that. It's not even sometimes what their constituents really need. Instead, it's what their constituents think they need or what they believe in terms of their ideology. And they think, I only have to do that, because all that matters is whether I'm reelected or not. And that's a problem. It's a huge problem in our world today. The data is clear. If you want to be happier, if you want to find joy in your life, you have to believe and you have to have a purpose each and every day. And what was the third thing that I talked about? Community. Community. So we can keep going down a path of individuality, isolation with technology, separating ourselves in our own homes, separating ourselves, home, not getting to know our neighbors very well, in our own homes, separating ourselves, one-on-one TV here, one-on-one phone there, or we can decide that community matters. And we can be an example of that to our world, in and through life in Christ Jesus, every single Sunday. We can be an example to our schools by participating in the PTA and other wonderful programs that our schools are running. We can be involved in the ministerium events that are put on and say, it's not just this church, it's not just our schools, it's everybody in our community that we need to welcome with love. We need to show mercy to those who are hurting. Don't forget what happened. I didn't tell you, I didn't read the end. So there's a question at the end. Should you not have mercy upon that slave just as I had mercy on you? What follows after that is not good news. It's a profound warning that if we don't show mercy to those who are indebted in mind, body, and spirit, those who have not had the same blessed upbringing that you and I have had, and the same opportunity that you and I have had, if we do not show mercy upon them and seek to bring that same opportunity to them, then trouble is ahead. And friends, I don't want to end the good news with bad news. So get involved. Get involved. Friends, the way that we build our faith is by getting involved in small groups. The men are going out on September 29th. Men, let's all get together and break bread and have some drinks and have a wonderful time. Maybe we'll even get around to talking about God a little bit. The women are going to be going on a retreat. I don't know if they can still go on the retreat or not, but that's up and coming. And Johnsonburg's an incredible place. So talk to Linda. There's other things that the women are brainstorming and thinking about. So let Linda know if there's things that you want to get going at our church or things that you want to get involved in. The crop walk. Let's witness to the kind of peace that Jesus showed the world. Getting together and raising money for those who are hungry and those who are suffering from natural disasters. Let's get out there, man. More natural disasters, it seems, every single year. I don't know if we're just more and more in touch with them because of 24-hour news, but the data, I believe, is clear. The frequency and the severity of these things keep increasing. And so may this year be the year that we raise more money than ever in our community for people who are hurting. Get involved, because that's the way you're going to find joy. You're going to build up your faith. You're going to build up fellowship in the Holy Spirit. You're going to receive the gifts and the joys of others. You're going to be serving the purpose for which you were created. And in doing all of these things, you're going to find the joy that God has prepared for you. And he can do far more abundantly in you than all you can ask or imagine. So to God be the glory. in the church and in Christ Jesus now and forevermore. And God's people say, amen. Try to remember what the writer of Hebrews said. Do good for God. Oh, I should have written it down. For God loves what is pleasing, or something like that. Do good. The Apostle Paul said to give gladly, because God loves a cheerful giver. So let us respond to the word of God with the glad offerings of our lives and our labor. Let's stand and sing as we do so.
Lord, we are grateful for all the blessings with which you shower us, the gifts that you have given to us of health and sunshine, stars and resources, friends and family. And we are so, so grateful for the most precious gift of yourself to us, that in everything, you are with us and we are never alone. Even if our bodies are not what we would like, you walk with us in those times. And we are so, so grateful for that. And Lord, we lift up ourselves and our community to you this day. We bring before you concerns on our hearts. We think of those who are suffering natural disasters, fires and famines, wars. Oh Lord, so many wars throughout our world. So many people have driven from their homes, not by choice, but because they can't even live where they've been living. We pray that you would be with those people. We pray too for our leaders. Lord, we know our own failings, and some of our leaders' failings are very much before us. But we know too that but for you, we might even be walking in those same places. And so we lift up our leaders to you, and we pray that you would reach down and touch them and give them wisdom and grace and mercy. Lord, we thank you for our teachers. We thank you for those that lead our children and our youth. We thank you for those in our own congregation that you have called to teach. And we ask your blessing upon them. We thank you for the young people that you have entrusted to our care. And Lord, as I see some who are seeking to know more about you in our confirmation class this day, we pray your blessing upon them, that you might teach them of yourself, and that they might come to know you and grow in you. Thank you that we have the privilege of leading them. And Lord, we thank you for those that watch over our safety. We thank you for fire and police and those in the military service. We thank you of their gift of time and of themselves. We thank you for their families who let them go to serve us. And we pray your blessing upon each one, whether they are serving here in our own communities or far across the world. May you let yourself be known to them this day. And Lord, we bring before you too those who are grieving. Lord, you know who they are. We ask that you would touch them with your hope, the power of your resurrection, that they might know that this is not the end of life, that life continues with you. And so we too lift up before you those that are on our hearts with our voices raised or in silence before you.
Wendell. Programs of the church and leaders.
Programs and leaders of the church. We pray for our committees looking for new staff.
Amen.
And Lord, we pray together as you have taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thy tent shall be our home.
Amen. I want to start by giving thanks for Nemat Idisa. And stand up in the balcony, please, Nemat. She does an amazing job every single week with our live stream and with our slides. So thank you so much, Nemat. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. We are made for love and for mercy. So whenever you encounter somebody who's hurting in mind, body, or spirit, bring the healing presence of Jesus Christ and receive a benediction. The grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all now and forevermore. And God's people say, Amen.